Hello and welcome once again to the program DPR, the Petroleum Industry Regulator. Today our focus is on the nation's crude oil export terminals. I know your ears are wide open to know what is happening there. You know, crude oil export makes up about 40% of the country's gross domestic products and about 90% of her foreign exchange earnings. One thing you will be sure of is that the Department of Petroleum Resources personnel are at these 25 terminals round the clock every year just to monitor and regulate activities at these very sensitive areas. Yes, they do. Now they have even gone digital, as every drop of crude oil exported from the shores or deep water of Bight of Guinea of the Nigeria territorial waters is recorded real time and reported immediately at the headquarters. Now, well, you'll get to know more about this at our usual DPR tidbits. I'm Sulaiman. As the $9 billion mega complex housing Africa's largest oil refinery inches towards completion at the end of 2020, an energy specialist, Dr. Nwoke Okala, amongst others notable Nigerians, has called on Nigeria to consciously diversify from its current dependence on oil. Dr. Okala of the Center for Research and Development, University of Nigeria, Nsukka, says Nigeria should follow the global trend of exploring renewable energy sources as oil is gradually becoming less attractive. Now, the upcoming refinery owned by Nigerian business magnate and Africa's richest investor Aliko Dangote has an expected annual refining capacity of 10.4 million tons of gasoline. This will double Nigeria's refining potentials and go a long way in helping the nation meet her domestic demands, as well as transform Nigeria from a fuel importer to a fuel exporter. Oil. In 2019, the annual International Energy Agency Outlook for Global Oil Markets has observed that with the implementation of the International Maritime Organization's new rules governing bunker fuel quality in 2020, product markets are on the verge of one of the biggest shakeups ever seen. Fifth Birol, IEA executive director, said, "These are times of extraordinary change for the oil industry. Everywhere we look, new actors are emerging and certainties of the past are fading." End of quote. Now, the report adds that the incredible growth in U.S. shale from almost next to nothing to over 7 million barrels per day at the beginning of 2019 is transforming global oil markets. This is because the U.S. shale is able to respond to price signals more swiftly than other sources of supply. The report also notes that the U.S. will lead global oil supply in the next 6 years.
This is a special announcement from the Department of Petroleum Resources. Gas is safe. Gas cylinders are to be kept outside. If you're buying LPG cylinder, look for NIS number on the cylinder. Exchange of gas cylinders with retailers during purchase is best practice instead of refilling from another cylinder. Buy gas from certified LPG plant. Repairing faulty gas cylinders is unsafe. For more information, visit the nearest DPR office or our website www.dpr.gov.ng.
Where and when anything crude oil is mentioned, all eyes, and I mean all eyes and ears, are wide open to know what is happening. Nobody's left out of the discussion, even those who have not seen it before. This product, crude oil, is very important to the economy of our country and the running of various tiers of government. And the Department of Petroleum Resources knows it, and that explains why it is one of its core responsibilities to monitor what goes on at these terminals daily. Now, today there are 29 crude oil export terminals in the country. Some of them are inside the Atlantic Ocean. However, only 25 of these terminals are currently operational. Well, we go over to the background report for more on these terminals and what the Department of Petroleum Resources does to monitor and regulate the activities there.
The first crude oil production began in Nigeria in 1956 with the drilling of the first well at Iho in today's Imo State. However, in the same 1956, another well was drilled at Oloibiri in today's Bayelsa State. That well yielded the first commercial crude oil for Nigeria. All these efforts were driven by Shell BP. These developments by Shell BP attracted more companies to Nigeria to prospect for crude oil. The companies include Mobil Producing Nigeria, now ExxonMobil, and Gulf Oil, now Chevron, from the United States of America. Others include Safrap from France, now Total Oil, Elf from France, and now part of Total Nigeria, as well as an Italian company known as Agip Oil Company. However, the first crude oil export from Nigeria took place in February 1958 with the vessel MT Hemiphysus. It lifted about 18,000 barrels of crude oil from the present-day Wheat and Bush Company premises at a reclaimed area of Port Harcourt Wharf. The dynamics changed quickly as the first crude oil lift from a terminal constructed in Nigeria took place in Bonny in today's River State in June 1961. The lifting was done by a vessel known as Atel Chief, while the first offshore crude oil lifting was from the same Bonny terminal in 1973 by a vessel known as MV Niso. As prospecting and production of crude oil in the country increased, so also the building of crude oil terminals. A crude oil export terminal is an industrial facility for the storage of crude oil. It is from this facility that the export-grade crude oil is transported to the buyer. In other words, it is the point where ownership of the crude oil changes. Today, there are 29 crude oil export terminals in Nigeria. Out of these, 25 are operational, while the remaining 4 are moribund. These 29 export terminals are of different types. They include onshore terminals like the Bonny, Brass, Forcados, Escravos, and Kwaibo terminals. Brass terminal is owned by Agip Nigeria, while Kwaibo is owned by Mobil Producing Nigeria Unlimited. Each of these terminals has a total storage capacity of 8.5 million barrels, making them the largest. Others include floating, production, storage and export vessels, FPSO. These types of terminals are in the shallow and deep waters of the country, known as Bight of Guinea. They have mooring buoys with hoses attached to the FPSO vessels from where they load crude oil. The FPSO is a vessel on its own that produces crude oil from the bottom of the ocean. It treats the crude oil and separates crude oil, water, gas, and impurities. It stores this crude in the vessels pending when a buying vessel anchors on a nearby mooring buoy. Some of these FPSOs include Bonga with a total storage capacity of 2 million barrels, while ERA, owned by Mobil, has a total storage capacity of about 2.4 million barrels. Agbami, owned by Chevron, has a total capacity of about 2.2 million barrels. Others include Osa, Apu, Okoro, and Pennington. The last of the terminals is a floating storage and offloading vessel, FSO. This facility is used only to store and export crude oil and not for production of crude oil and gas. The production is done through platforms and the crude oil is pumped into these floating storage and offloading vessels. The crude oil exported from these FSOs must be of export grade with the maximum water quantity allowed. Some of these FSOs include Tija, Britannia U, Yoho, Ima, and Ibok. However, there are other major facilities at the export terminals. They include calibrated tanks, pumps, valves and pipelines from the fields, and pipelines for the transfer of crude oil to the export tankers. A standard crude oil export terminal must have a laboratory for quality control and analysis, a metering system for the measurement of crude oil export quantity, and a central control system. Finally, the terminal must have a jetty loading platform and export hoses connected to single mooring buoy SBM. With these equipment installed in a standard terminal, crude oil is received from the oil fields across the Niger Delta area and then processed. The processing of the crude oil is to get export-grade crude quality, and this is done through complex or simple separation techniques. A sample is then taken to the installed terminal laboratory to determine the quality and properties of the crude oil. Thereafter, the crude oil is measured before pumping into a nominated export tanker vessel. It is at this point that export documents are signed off, and at the same time, a certificate of quantity and quality is issued to the buyer by the Department of Petroleum Resources. There are other roles the Department of Petroleum Resources play at the export terminals. These include monitoring of all the activities at the terminals to ensure that they are conducted in line with applicable guidelines, regulations, and laws. The department also performs the focalization for crude oil stock, production, and export volumes.
I'll now hand you over to my colleague Anthony Amusa to handle the interview segment. Now, don't go anywhere, because the segment will throw more light into how the export terminals in the country are monitored and regulated.
Hello, and welcome again to this segment of the program. Today, we'll be discussing with Dr. Akin Musa. He is the Assistant Director, Crude Oil Terminal Operations, Downstream Monitoring and Regulations of the DPR. Dr. Musa, you are most welcome.
Thank you very much.
When we talk of crude oil terminals and downstream monitoring and regulations, what do we really mean?
The Crude Oil Terminal and Monitoring Regulation is a branch of the downstream division in the Department of Petroleum Resources, in charge with all the produced crude oil that is pumped into the terminal, and is also in charge of monitoring, regulation, supervision, accounting, and many other functional responsibility with regards to export of the crude oil from our nation's terminal.
So when we're talking of export, I know that we have Forcados and Brass terminals. So how many export terminals do we have in this country aside from these two I have mentioned?
Actually, we have 29, and 25 are functional. 5 of them have, for some reason, they're not operational for now.
So where are these terminals mostly based?
The major part of the terminals, the large number of terminals we have in Nigeria today, they are mostly offshore. And we have 5 that are onshore, while 24 are offshore.
So can you explain to ordinary people watching this program, when we say onshore, offshore, what do we really mean?
Onshore means on the land, and it's land-based, and you have facilities clearly on the land for the operation of the terminals. When we talk about offshore, as the name implies, that is, you have gone deeper into the sea, where you have the facilities located in the deep marine waters, surrounded by waters. It could be a FSO or FPSO. FSO stands for floating storage and offload, while FPSO stands for floating storage production and offload.
You said we have about 25 of such export terminals. And do you think or consider such number adequate enough for the 2.3 million barrels of crude oil Nigeria is currently producing?
Yes, they are quite adequate. For example, we have the largest onshore terminals. That is the Kwaibo terminal, operated by ExxonMobil. 8.5 million barrel nominal capacity. I mean, total capacity of the... While we have the minimum, which is the Britannia U, about 80,000 barrels of crude oil storage capacity. So, and many others
But do you think they will still be adequate if we are able to achieve our dream of producing like 3.6 to 4.0 million barrels crude oil per day that the federal government is targeting?
Yes, very well. They can actually accommodate this large volume of the crude oil that we are expecting. If we reach 3.5, of course, we'll have the possibility of having all these facilities to accommodate the storage and the offload of the crude oil from the nation's terminal. It's possible.
Well, we hear about oil condensate. What is that? And then how do you monitor the production of this oil condensate?
Yes, oil condensates are lighter, very lighter crude oil of API. Sorry to use the word FPI. Stands from American Petroleum Institute.
Okay.
It's a measuring scale. Okay. Of about 45, 46, 47 API degree, or the if you use specific density, is very lighter than the crude oil, of course, and it's close to gasoline in terms of the density range.
Okay. Then, so how do you monitor the production of the coal condensate?
They are produced alongside with the crude oil, and then the crude oil is streamed off in a process of separation at the flow station. Of course, we have the gas, the natural gas liquids that leaves the well to the terminal, where it's knocked off. That is, the condensate is knocked off before the pure gas.
Is it knocked off? Is it like separation?
Very good. It's a technical term for separation.
Okay.
It's separated before it gets to other facilities that further separates the gas component into smaller components. For example, you can separate it into LNG, liquefied natural gas, propane, butane, and of course, pentane.
Okay, I see. Well, there's always this assumption that, and it's what many people have held on to, that we can't specifically say what quantity of crude oil we produce in this country. Do you agree with that assertion? And if not, can you tell us in precise terms what quantity of crude oil do we produce daily in this country?
As Department of Petroleum Resources, we can tell exactly how much crude oil is produced from the wells in this country, both onshore, land and swamp.
So why do Nigerians believe that there is no accurate figure? If DPR can categorically say there is a figure.
I think it's lack of awareness. That's the first thing. Secondly, it's lack of the knowledge that DPR website actually exists, that gives you more information on how we monitor the wells, how we produce the crude oil, how we monitor the separation, how we monitor the storage, and of course how we monitor the export of the crude oil. Our staff are always in the terminal. That is the last point where all the crude oil is gathered. It's a gathering station where all the crude oil is gathered. Our staff are always there 24 hours a day and throughout the year, even during the holidays. So we are always there to make sure that all the physical measuring equipments are functional.
So what do we produce as of, let's say, January 2020?
Yes, we produce per day average of about 1.7 to 1.8 million barrels per day. However, we have situations where we due to process upset, or sabotage, theft, or some other incidences that requires emergency action to be taken so as to prevent the environment from being polluted.
What you have said, the measures in place seems very elaborate and very thorough, but we still hear of crude oil theft. Does it really happen, and how is it feasible with all these measures in place?
Yes, crude oil theft, as big as they say, but actually the theft actually happens at the at some of the pipelines in the Niger Delta. What happens is that thieves come maybe at night to hot tap. What I mean by hot tap is to drill a hole on the pipeline and take some of the crude oil, either for illegal refineries or for other purposes which I don't know. However, DPR has a way of monitoring that now. We have the National Production Monitoring System.
Yes, because I wanted you to talk about the collaboration between DPR and the Navy particularly, because they are the ones that are always tracking down some of these vessels who are maybe on their ICs with our crude oil. How do you work with them?
In fact, we have synergy with the Navy, the customs, in every evacuation of crude oil from any point to the final destination.
In answering one of the questions, you talked about monitoring of real-time of vessels, and I'm sure of export of crude oil from the production point to their destination. Can you tell us exactly how this is done?
Let me start from the NPMS, the National Production System. Once the crude oil starts leaving the shores of the terminal, the NPMS is configured into the terminal LAC system. LAC system stands for the Least Automatic Custody Transfer Unit. This is a system that has meters, gauges, proving systems, and other and the purpose is to determine the actual volume. So as the fluid is being pumped through this LAC system, it is being recorded live, and the signals are sent to this portal, and the minister can see it as it's producing, as it's flowing into the terminal. On completion, it also shows that this is the end of the export operation.
That brings me to the next question of how do you monitor and control many of these operators of this at the terminals, and most of them are not local operators. How do you really monitor them?
For every activity in the oil industry, starting from the concept to design to construction to operation, maintenance, and decommissioning, DPR is involved.
Okay, but for some companies who still, in spite of everything, where there are infractions, what sanctions are there in place for them?
Yes, we have deterrence to non-compliance, and we have them there in the guidelines. We have them in the regulations, and we also have them in the Petroleum Act.
Well, Dr. Musa, when you were talking about compliance, we didn't talk about the issue of metering and calibration. How does DPR ensure that all these things work as they should?
Central to compliance is the issue of calibration. Calibration is a very important part of the process of ensuring that the physical measuring equipments are measuring the volumes of the crude oil or petroleum accurately. Starting from your wellhead that use multi-phase meters to the production platform or the flow station that use allocation meters or production, but for monitoring purposes. And also the storage tank where you store the fluid or the hydrocarbons. And the meters that measure this crude oil for export purposes. Calibration, in fact, starts from the manufacturer. That's what we call factory acceptance test.
So I want to thank you very much, Dr. Aken Musa, the Assistant Director, Crude Oil Terminal Operations, Downstream Monitoring and Regulations of the DPR. Thank you so much for your time.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
Here I draw the curtain again for the day. But do not forget to join me next week for a more exciting topic on how the Department of Petroleum Resources guides and protects the very important Nigerian oil and gas industry. It's goodbye from me.